From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, Professor of Medicine at Boston University and Senior Editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Gilaad Kaplan, who is Professor in the Cumming School of Medicine at the University of Calgary. Welcome, Dr. Kaplan, to this JAMA podcast.
Thank you so much for inviting me to talk about ulcerative colitis.
Absolutely. So let's get started. Your review covers the diagnosis and management of ulcerative colitis in adults. To begin with, can you give our listeners an overview of the epidemiology of ulcerative colitis?
Yeah, so ulcerative colitis, it's a disorder of inflammation of the bowel. It's a disease that has an incidence in North America of roughly 15 per 100,000 per year. And the prevalence in 2023 is estimated to be about 400 per 100,000 people, 0.4% of the population, which means roughly 1.5 million people are living with ulcerative colitis in North America today.
Now, when a patient presents with symptoms suggestive of ulcerative colitis, what is your recommended diagnostic approach?
There are a lot of clear symptoms that happen. So first of all, if you're like a generalist seeing somebody, the most common presentation of symptoms is going to be things like having rectal bleeding, diarrhea, bowel urgency. So these are kind of clinical clues to suggest that we should be thinking about something like Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. The differential diagnosis is broad, and so we have to do a number of different things, including important medical history. We can do investigations like looking at CBC, looking for hemoglobin and ferritin, looking at a C-reactive protein. We want to do stool cultures to rule out other infectious causes like bacteria or C. diff toxin tests for Clostridium difficile. One of the really important diagnostic tests that you can do as a generalist is a test called the fecal calprotectin. This has a very high sensitivity and specificity to differentiate ulcerative colitis from other non-IBD diagnosis. And ultimately, these are clues to tell you that this might be underlying ulcerative colitis, which then leads you to seeing a gastroenterologist who then do the definitive diagnostic test, which is a sigmoidoscopy or colonoscopy with biopsies. And then with that, you can get pathology that confirms the diagnosis.
Excellent. And if the sigmoidoscopy was negative, would you proceed to a colonoscopy?
So for ulcerative colitis, the classic appearance of ulcerative colitis is it does start at the anorectal junction and continues circumferentially with diffuse inflammation without a break until you see a clear transition zone or it reaches the end of the colon. Sigmoidoscopy is the diagnostic test to rule it in or rule it out. Now, we often will do a colonoscopy to look for other causes, in particular Crohn's disease that can spare the colon. So you want to end up looking at the colon and looking at the small bowel. But specifically to diagnose ulcerative colitis, if a sigmoidoscopy is negative, you've essentially ruled out the disease.
Now, what are some of the most common extra-intestinal manifestations of ulcerative colitis, and which of these may actually precede the onset of GI symptoms?
So extra-intestinal manifestations are quite common. Roughly about 1 in 4 people with ulcerative colitis through the course of their diagnosis will present with extra-intestinal manifestations. And some of them can actually precede the diagnosis. In fact, most of them can be diagnosed either before or after. Some are associated with bowel inflammation and others occur independently. So I've reviewed many of them in the article, but I'll just list a few of them here to highlight the more common ones. So the most common extra-intestinal manifestation is joint pain. It occurs roughly about 10% of people with ulcerative colitis. Peripheral arthritis, and the most classic of that is what we call a type 1 arthritis, where we see less than 5 asymmetrical large joints like the elbow or the ankle. This is associated with bowel inflammation. And so these ones typically go with the disease. So if you have active inflammation, you have active peripheral arthritis. Now, in contrast, the other joint condition that we see in roughly about 4% of people with ulcerative colitis is ankylosing spondylitis and sacroiliitis. And these conditions are independent bowel inflammation. So it can be diagnosed before the diagnosis of ulcerative colitis, or it can be identified after the diagnosis of ulcerative colitis. The other common inflammatory condition is eye inflammation. It's typically about episcleritis or uveitis, occurring about 2% of people. Sometimes it's associated with bowel inflammation, but can also occur independently, and again, can be potentially diagnosed before ulcerative colitis. The two most common skin conditions are erythema nodosum and pyoderma gangrenosum. They occur roughly about 1% of people with ulcerative colitis. Erythema nodosum is a painful red palpable rash, typically on the shin. It's associated with a number of conditions, including ulcerative colitis, and can occur before the diagnosis. Pyoderma gangrenosum is actually a deep, non-healing skin ulcer, and it occurs independent of inflammation. And the last one I'd mention is primary sclerosing cholangitis. It occurs in roughly 2.5% of ulcerative colitis patients. It's independent bowel inflammation, it's inflammation of the bile ducts. And what's fascinating is that most people with inflammatory bowel disease who get primary sclerosing cholangitis, the PSC can happen either before or after. And so if somebody's diagnosed with primary sclerosing cholangitis, we'll often do a colonoscopy to rule out ulcerative colitis, even if they're not having active symptoms of inflammation.
I did have a patient who presented with a skin condition called morphia. How common is that before ulcerative colitis?
Morphia is not as common. It's not one of the most common skin conditions. There's actually a number of different skin conditions. Another one that we see is called sweet syndrome or neutrophil dermatosis. It can present with papules. And the other important thing to recognize is there's a number of skin conditions that can occur as a relationship to some of the treatments that we use. So for example, anti-TNF therapies can sometimes cause psoriasis.
Interesting. Well, that's a great segue into my next question, which is, how has treatment for ulcerative colitis evolved in recent years, and what therapies do you consider to be first line?
So first of all, there's been a tremendous evolution in the treatment of ulcerative colitis, and that relates to our deeper understanding of the pathogenesis of the disease. That's allowed us to develop a number of different targets for ulcerative colitis. But ultimately, it's really important to define the location, the disease location, and the disease severity. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to break up the management to mild to moderate ulcerative colitis compared to moderate to severe. So starting with mild to moderate, there's a few different things that we can do to risk stratify. The Mayo score is a clinical indice that is commonly used to stratify and identify mild to moderate ulcerative colitis. Typically with mild to moderate ulcerative colitis, you're having 1 to 2 or 3 to 4 bowel movements above your baseline. You're seeing some blood in your stool. And when you do a colonoscopy, you see inflammation, but you're not seeing kind of the deep ulcers that we see with moderate to severe disease. In that situation, you then look to see, well, where is the location of the disease? Is it limited to the rectum? We call that proctitis. Or is it more extensive through the left side of the colon or even through the entire colon? If you have that mild to moderate disease and it's limited just to the rectum, then we can use topical therapies. And so one of the classic topical therapies is 5-amino salicylates. I'll call it 5-ASA from now on. For proctitis, we can use topical 5-ASA suppositories. And then if you have more extensive disease, there was a randomized trial that showed if you use both oral and topical enema therapies together, that did better than using oral or enema on their own. And so we'll often use that for induction therapy for the first 8 weeks. And then once people are well, you can then drop the enemas and cut the dose of the 5-ASA in half and use that. So really, those are your primary first-line treatments for mild to moderate ulcerative colitis. Now, where we get into a little bit more of the complexity is what happens if you don't respond to 5-ASA therapy, or when you're doing that risk stratification to begin with, you're actually dealing with much more severe disease. And that's kind of that moderate to severe ulcerative colitis picture. In that situation, you're now segueing into trying to get people well. And we often will use a course of prednisone. We've been using prednisone since the 1950s, and it's still a mainstay of therapy for induction of moderate to severe disease in 2023. We typically use prednisone tapering course, like 40 milligrams a day for 7 days, and taper by 5 milligrams every week thereafter. One of the things that we've recognized from a number of studies is that prednisone has a lot of adverse events. It's not effective for maintenance therapy. So we think of it as a bridge to advanced therapies. Here's where it gets really interesting is the advanced therapies. They range from things like thiopurines to a whole series of biologics to oral small molecules that we can use now to treat these kind of moderate to severe patients with ulcerative colitis.
Excellent. And just for our US listeners, I wanted to confirm the 5-ASA would be the mesalamine enema and the oral would be sulfasalazine. Is that correct?
So sulfasalazine is essentially the mesalamine core aspect to it. Sulfasalazine was the original 5-aminosalicylate that was identified, has a sulfa moiety to it. It's associated with sulf-related side effects. So right now, most of the treatment for ulcerative colitis are the mesalamine-based products.
What are some of the complications of ulcerative colitis that are indications for hospitalization and or surgery?
When we think about ulcerative colitis, we have to start thinking about it in the context of some people will develop what's called acute severe ulcerative colitis. There's a number of ways to recognize. One of the simple ways that we use is what's called the True Love and Wits classification. Essentially, it's a person with greater than 6 bloody stools per day, but they're also developing systemic features: fever, tachycardia, anemia, and elevated CRP. And this is an emergency because you can develop complications like toxic megacolon, hemorrhage, perforation, things like that. We need to treat these people in hospital. So roughly about 20% of people with ulcerative colitis will be admitted to hospital within the first 5 years of diagnosis. Not admission, we do an x-ray to rule out a toxic megacolon. We'll do stool cultures and a C. diff toxin to make sure there isn't a secondary infection that's triggered. Because of the risk of venous thromboembolisms, we prophylax people in hospital with low molecular weight heparin. We do a sigmoidoscopy at the time of admission to look for disease severity, but also for biopsy for secondary complications like viral infections like CMV. People can get malnourished and lose weight, and so we do a nutritional assessment. And the colorectal team are our teammates. We refer them up front, not necessarily because we're going to do surgery on day one, but because we want them to be part of the team. And we'll often do things like a QuantiFERON as a pre-biologic workup in anticipation that we might be starting more advanced therapies like anti-TNF therapy. Everyone in the hospital started on IV corticosteroids. And the key thing is around day three, we look to see what is that response. And one example of that is we can use the Oxford criteria. That's if somebody's still having 8 or more stools per day, despite being on 3 days of IV steroids, or they're having fewer bowel movements, but they have a really high CRP, then that's a signal that we need to use advanced therapy such as anti-TNF to see if we can break the cycle of being steroid refractory and try to prevent a colectomy from occurring.
Moving from the inpatient setting to the outpatient setting, let's talk a little bit about health maintenance. And how do health maintenance needs differ for patients with ulcerative colitis relative to other patients?
There's a lot of things that you can do in regards to health maintenance. I talk through a lot of them in the article and just will highlight a few key ones. I think one of the most important one is thinking about colon cancer and colorectal cancer. If you look at the risk of developing colon cancer from being diagnosed with ulcerative colitis, it's only about 0.8% within the first 10 years of diagnosis, but then climbs to 2% within 10 to 20 years and almost 5% when you start going after 20 years. And so that means that we start to do colorectal cancer screening around 8 to 10 years from diagnosis, particularly people who have inflammation that goes beyond their rectum. That's really important to know and to recognize, because if somebody, let's say, has ulcerative colitis or being seen by a generalist, they haven't seen a gastroenterologist for a while, it's an important thing to recognize and to then refer to a gastroenterologist to do that. Other important things in regard to vaccinations, this is really important in the context of people who are immunosuppressed by their therapies. We always think about mental health screening as well, because we know that there's a slightly higher risk for depression, anxiety, or both inflammatory bowel disease. And then thinking about if somebody's had a course of corticosteroids, there's at risk for bone density loss, and so bone density screening. So these are some examples of things you can do from a health maintenance perspective.
Certainly. And patients on biologics, should they not receive the live vaccines?
So any non-live vaccines are totally safe. In fact, we try to vaccinate for so many different vaccine-preventable illnesses. But live vaccines, particularly if you're immunosuppressed, we avoid live vaccines in those settings.
My final question is, what is the prognosis for patients diagnosed with ulcerative colitis over time?
Overall, the prognosis for somebody with ulcerative colitis is very good. People have good quality of life. The risk of needing a colectomy is roughly about 10% after 10 years of being diagnosed. Even people who have a colectomy live a good long life with good quality of life. But when we step back and look at people with ulcerative colitis as compared to those who don't have it, we do see some differences. So for example, there was a study looking at what is the life expectancy for somebody with ulcerative colitis. And for the most part, the life expectancy is long into the late 70s or early 80s, depending if you're a male or a female, but it's roughly 5 years shorter than somebody with out ulcerative colitis. In 2023, with so many advances in medical therapies, we're doing a really good job at keeping people out of hospitals, out of the surgery, with good quality of life.
That's good to know. Thank you for listening today. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking with Dr. Gil Kaplan from the University of Calgary about the diagnosis and management of ulcerative colitis. This episode was produced by Shelley Steppens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thank you for listening.